Before we get started today, and I'm so glad that many of you are keeping up as we seek to serve you during this time. Yes, do we want to respect what the medical professionals are saying? Absolutely. But how do we also serve God in the midst of it? You know, he says, all things work together for good to those who love the Lord. If you love me, you keep my commandments. It'll work out for our advantageous natures and life that we need. It'll work out for our good. It'll be productive for us, add blessings to us. So we're trying to balance that. But in doing that, I do want to take a minute at the end of what we're doing today to pray for our medical professionals. A lot of them are on the line there. We've had some members here at Living Word that are medical professionals, and they're there taking care of people every day. We also have our politicians, our leaders that are out there trying to make the best decisions possible. And we have our police officers and now our National Guard in some cities that have families. They have families. And my brother always reminds me that soldiers have families and not just soldiers. They have families, and we need to pray for them. So at the end of what we do today, as we look at 2 Chronicles chapter 7, I want to remember to pray for our medical professionals, our military that is out there, the ship that was out at sea with a lot of people sick on that ship. So a lot of issues going on that we may not even know about as we look at this virus and how aggressive it is in spreading and then how damaging it could be. You know, folks, in the midst of all of this, sometimes we ask ourselves, why is God allowing this? Why is God shutting down the world? Why is God causing the world to come to a halt? Well, why would he even let Easter go by? Why would he allow the church to go through Easter and not be able to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ? Good questions. I want us to take a look because many times, and we're going to break this up into segments here each week because I want to walk through this with you. Many times when we first look at everything, we think of all the things that are going wrong out there. We think of all the way people are living out there. We immediately start to say, they're living this way. They don't go to church. They don't do these things. And we point the finger at all the different things that we have so long a list that we can look at. But that's how the scriptures do it. Yes, there's times when God would do situations where he would destroy the earth because it's so wicked in front of him. It's like stench in his nostrils in the days of Noah. There are times that in Sodom and Gomorrah when he would destroy a city. There are times that God will go to Nineveh and would save that city because he is going to use that city to come against his people because his people wouldn't listen to him. The Bible says when judgment in 1 Peter chapter 4 begins in the household of God, then what would be the outcome of the world? See, the Bible starts it within us. We are a nation unto God. We are the salt and the light. We are the ones that understand the importance of the local church. The only place that he is committed to, the only way that anybody could grow spiritually, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1 all the way to the verse 16 explains, is in the church. There's no other way. It's like a human being can best be developed in a family. Best be developed in a family. Does that mean the human being left to themselves would not physically get taller, physically get stronger? That person will be able to think and go to school? Yes. But for them to grow up in the most productive way is to be in a family that is deeply committed to raising their kids and to extending love to their children and to being committed as a husband and wife to develop what God is saying. That brings the best family, best individual. Same thing it is when it comes to a person within a local church. Does that mean that we can just have church and that solves it? No, the church has to be the church. And the way God designed it, not the way we designed it, where we say we have to have it this kind of time. It must be in this kind of hour situation. It must do this, must sing these kind of songs. The preacher must do this. Church is not about us. Church is about Christ. Church is about modeling Christ to the world. It's about making a statement to the world that Christ lives and is powerful and is functioning in a mighty way. That's the church. He's saying what the purposes of the church is. He's saying he could leave the church. A lampstand can be taken from a church. Revelation gives us all the reasons why it can happen. It could be the most popping church in the community. He talks about that in chapter 3. Well, he's leaving that church. So he doesn't mean that because we're having church, he's there. The Bible says, no, he could leave there because he determines how church is. And when it's not that way, and we persist and have an attitude about what he is saying, and he says, no problem, it's all yours. And he walks out the door. Folks, that's what the Bible teaches. We don't like these kind of messages. We kind of get upset about them. But that tells us where our heart is. When the Bible is teaching us something, we can't turn around and tell it what to say to us. That's when we jump into the last days, when we will try to find people who would say what we want them to say. The Bible says we will do those kind of things in the last days. That's exactly what happened to Christ when he was on earth. They didn't like the message he was preaching, so they nailed him to a cross and went about doing things the way they want to do them. And what happened to them? Israel has suffered as a result. So folks, I want us to look at 2 Chronicles chapter 7 for just a few weeks. And I ain't going to do it forever, don't worry. This is a time when the tabernacle was established. You know, Solomon has followed his dad's prescription as to what to do. He's followed it to a T. He's all excited from verse 4. Matter of fact, you can read from verse 1 all the way on where he's excited. He is killing animals and sacrificing to God, having a day of consecration and dedication as he opens up the temple doors as people are singing and dancing before God. And then God responds. I want you to see how God is, because, you know, we tend to think, especially when we open up a new sanctuary, we dedicated it, committed it to God. But at the end of the day, I don't mean that because we did it that way, he's going to show up because we did it. No, God don't follow our instructions, folks. He is Lord. Who could stop this virus until he says, okay, no problem. I'm going to go ahead and move forward now. We're struggling because when God decides to do something, who could stop him? Who could stop him? So sometimes because of our degrees and accomplishments and what we've been able to achieve with all the money we've got now, we think we got the power. No, we don't. God has brought us to our knees to show us he has the power. We are like Moses would say, a mighty man like Moses who stood with a stick, and the power of God allowed him to open the Red Sea. He had to say, we're like dust. We're here today and gone tomorrow. I don't know why we fool ourselves. This is what he says in this passage of scripture, and then we'll come back to this. The first thing I want to note here in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 12, is that he says, then, after Solomon has done all these things, killed animals, set up everything, put everything in place, then the Lord appeared to him. In other words, his heart proved to be right at this point in Solomon's life. His commitment to the Lord's house is strong in Solomon's life. His dad has taught him well. His mom, as a matter of fact, has raised him well. When you follow Bathsheba and Solomon, she raised Solomon with a heart for God. When his dad kicks into that, he finds a young man willing to do whatever he says and to follow God in whatever way he says. When Solomon has done that, then the Lord appeared. Sometimes we come to church and we think that we could drag God in because we are saved. The Bible says, no. I come because you have taken me serious and how you've walked before you came to church. You've walked before you walk into the holies of holies. That's the thing, and we'll stop at this and walk our way through this passage. But I'd love for you to read from verse 12 all the way through to verse 18, and it clearly talks about why pestilence come, why you had this all of these locusts to devour things in Kenya. It's in the scriptures, folks. The Bible says we have everything we need for life and godliness through the word of God. Everything. There's no dark corners. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 through 4. So I want us to focus on then the Lord appeared. When we come into worship, God comes because of how we function, because we have to realize this key thing. Here's the key thing, and I pray that you would join me on this journey, that you stay this journey with me so that we can grow through why is God allowing this and how are we responsible for this? How are we responsible for this? Well, let's point the finger at anybody else. How are we responsible for what is taking place when we're the salt and the light? Please remember, when they came to the temple, they sacrificed at the table of propitiation. This is a shortcut to it. Washed their hands in the laver, and then they went to the holies of holies, the high priest. What is the Bible saying? Jesus Christ died on the table of propitiation on Calvary's cross. What happens after that? He tells us to be baptized. Wash our hands. We baptize to represent his death and resurrection. And then we enter into his holies of holies. That's what he says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19 to 23. We go into his holy presence of God. Why would the nation of Israel stay in the wilderness so long? He says in chapter 8 of Deuteronomy, I wanted to test your hearts to see, will man live by bread alone, by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God? Because you choose not to do that, I only take those 20 and below in and have a fresh start. So all those people that were older never made it in after being in Egypt, struggling as slaves. Well, folks, It is not what the world is doing. The question is, how do we enter into the holies of holies? Do we come recognizing that we are in the very presence of God and we should come ready so that there is a then he appears, then he shows up in the worship because he sees how we came. Because when he tests our hearts, he found it ready to walk with him, to trust him, to worship him with a sincere heart, not just on Sunday, but in how we live our lives. I pray for that we stay this journey, and let's pray for medical professionals. Dear God, we thank you so much for those who are out there on the front lines doing all they can to serve and to save lives. God, especially the folks in New York. They're medical professionals that have died there. Please keep them safe, God. Please watch over all in Houston doing so much behind the scenes we don't even know about. Please keep them, Lord. Please keep our leaders with good wisdom so the decisions they make are inspired by you. Lord, I pray that you keep our military. They're out there because of there's so many of them for their commitment to our country. Please keep them safe. Lord, watch over our churches that you have. Lord, I pray that we would have a heart for you and that we will see that this is a time we must take you serious and not let these situations fulfill Matthew 24, where our hearts grow cold and we don't want to obey you. We question you. We don't trust you anymore. I pray, God, that would not be what happens, but that we'll find you to be someone blessed, someone we can trust, and we'll learn to love you more. We pray this, God. In the name of Jesus, we ask. Amen. Stay focused.